I've been having an interesting time as a visiting instructor at Simon Fraser, as I've mentioned to you. And it's resulted, I think, in a little bit of pain for some students here in terms of the assignments I've given and kind of the expectations that I've set. And I'm just starting to figure out maybe how things work here, and I'm sorry to be late at that. You guys probably have an idea. But it seems to me that there are some students who are enrolled in these classes who don't show up except for the midterms, and maybe, let's just say, they would like to get a degree here, but they don't necessarily care about learning. And maybe they can graduate with an economics degree with the full consent of the Simon Fraser administration without necessarily knowing economics. This is quite a distressing thing to think about for me, but I can see, from an economic perspective, I can see an equilibrium, let's say. I can see a quid pro quo. We give you our money, you give us a degree, don't ask too many questions. Now, the thing is that I assumed that was not going on, which was a mistake, I think. I'm not sure. There's this thing called let's just leave it at that. On the other hand, there are some of you here who are actually probably here right now who are trying to learn. And I don't want to mix up one group with the other. But what's part of the problem is that maybe you're trying to learn and maybe the economics hasn't been presented to you that I'm assuming you would have as third year university students, given that I taught this class at a very similar class at UC Berkeley 4 years ago. And I took for granted that certain things would be part of your previous classwork, and maybe now I'm discovering that some of these things were not part of your previous classwork, which means that I say, oh, you just go do a cost-benefit analysis, and whoa, maybe that hasn't been, you haven't gone over that many times, let's say. Or maybe the surplus is going to be obvious, but maybe you haven't gone over the social surplus discussion as often as I would have assumed. In fact, I don't necessarily care if you've gone over the stuff before. I do care that you understand the ideas. And what that means is that I need to teach those ideas to you before I assume you know them. So in that sense, I might need to go back and go over some stuff which I consider to be Economics 1 or Economics 101 or in this case 103 and make sure that you know it so that when I ask you a question about resources, about the environment, and so on, that you have the tools to work with. This requires you to help me by saying, I don't understand this, or in an email, raise your hand, I don't care. Because if you don't understand the basics, then I can't, as a foundation to what I'm trying to do, then you can't build on that foundation. Does that make sense? Okay. So in an email I said, bring me your questions to class. I don't know if anybody prepared questions. Hold that thought if you have prepared questions, because on the second half of this morning, I'm happy to go over any questions, like anything that you want to know about economics, especially with respect to, I don't know how to do this, and you're asking me to do the thing that depends on this. So if you have a question, it's fine. Bring it up, and I will try and address it. I may succeed or fail. The lecture that we had last week with Chris was really interesting to me, because he says, yeah, there's this thing called economic impact analysis. And I was like, what is this thing, right? This is, I've never seen it used in an economics class. And I've seen and taught a number of economics classes, so I was a little bit surprised. But of course, those of you who are writing the briefings and were reading all of these reports from the Canadian government, official reports, and of course from the oil companies that have their own propaganda, were thinking the only thing out there is economic impact analysis. Even though I asked you to write about the costs and benefits. You actually may not, some of you, and some of you may have been in a different situation, you may not have had the perspective or even the background of cost-benefit to do the analysis I was asking of you. And in that sense, it was not just a little bit unfair, but it was also one of the reasons why the questions on the midterm about jobs versus surplus and so on was so confusing because I hadn't created the correct framework. I had assumed it was there. And that's probably a big reason why I'm, whatever. I'm sorry, I'm upset, I feel like maybe we've wasted some time. I'm certainly frustrated, a number of you. I've had a lot of visits to office hours, which I always welcome. But it's very difficult for some people to be confronted with my expectations when you haven't necessarily had the background or the tools to deal with it. So I'm sorry about that. And as you know, everybody's in this class together. It's a curved situation. So I'm not trying to be unfair to any individual. I'm trying to be fair to everybody. So what I'm trying to do is change the terms of fairness. What that means is that people who are working hard to try and make this material work, if you're doing following the assignments in terms of just pure directions, right? You know, send me your blog post, but tell me a bottom line. Simple things will get you a long way. But on the other hand, if I'm saying, is a project with $100 of social surplus and 100 jobs versus $100 of social surplus and 50 jobs, if I present that question and everybody does badly, then you're nowhere different on the curve than you were before that question. If you do well, then maybe you're lucky, or maybe you thought about it in a different way. I don't know, but I'm still confident that people who are working hard and people who are learning will do well on this class. It's very understandable that you would worry about your grades, especially when it comes to progress in other areas. But I think it's more important in some ways that you at least know you're getting a fair chance to learn something, right? As opposed to me coming out in an economics class and asking you more or less chemistry questions. You're like, what is this? I've never seen this in this class. So I don't know if I'm overreacting, but there's no such thing as an underreaction in terms of teaching, so I'm going to do my best to put some more foundations in it today. We'll go to cost-benefit analysis. Now, does anybody have anything that they want to say or that I need to know, or is this a good idea that I'm, or am I saying something which is correct? Does that make sense to you? Kind of. I'm not saying, hey, let's slow it down and go one page a day, okay? What I'm saying is that I want to be able to give you the appropriate learning, because what I said at the first day of class is what I still mean. I want to teach you economics. When you walk out of the classroom, and more importantly, out of the university, I want to be someone who helps you use economic ideas to improve your life and theoretically do your work, right? But we'll see. Economics is really is about improving your life. All right, so that's my big noble speech. Deadlines and logistics. So let's go over a couple things. Number one, most important, there will not be class next Tuesday, because I will be across the city doing a water conference thing for basically people like you, 100 or so students or 50 students who are interested in water issues in particular. I will make sure that you have exciting videos to watch or something like that. That will give you some more background and perspective. Number two, of course, the briefing number two. Briefing number two is due on Thursday, not on Canvas, on Turnitin. The link was on the email I sent to you. Turnitin, as you know, or you will know in a minute, is an anti-plagiarism website. I had a very big problem with plagiarism last time. I'm not interested in spending 3 hours of my time double-checking everybody for plagiarism, something that nobody should be doing. Let me repeat what plagiarism is. It is taking someone else's words as your own. You can take their ideas. If you write their ideas in your own words, that's not plagiarism. If you write their ideas and you don't give any citation, that's not plagiarism. Okay? If you copy and paste something and you put quotation marks around it, so-and-so said this, quote, or quote, from somewhere, but more importantly, so-and-so said this, quote, that is not plagiarism. Okay? Plagiarism is copying and pasting someone else's words into your own work, more or less claiming that it's yours, without a notation that this is what somebody else said, without the quotation marks. Okay? I was a little bit sharp with some people who felt like, oh, but I said that so-and-so said this and I didn't put the marks. Those 5 points that you lost from those marks are meant to be a reminder called put quotation marks. Some people were blatantly stealing other people's work. If it happens again, and I have very good records, as you know, then I will just make sure they're failed, and I'll report them to the dean. There's a headline here. I don't know if anybody saw this. Anybody see this? Simon Fraser has 10 times the cheating disciplinary rate to UBC. UBC probably published this in their paper too, right? But so in some ways, there is a bit of a problem here on Simon Fraser. I'm not part of that problem. I don't want you guys to be part of the problem, right? The whole point of writing a briefing is that you write your words, right? It just blows my mind. Anyway, don't do that. We will also, that's one change for the briefing. The other change for the briefing is that the peer critiques of the briefing will be handed in on Canvas, but you will not put a grade into any of the critiques, okay? What you'll do is you'll name the file appropriately, email to come, and you'll submit the one that you rank A in a folder called A, and you'll submit the one that you rank B in a folder called B, so that the people who are receiving your feedback will get your feedback, but they will not get your grade. This is very important because there was a non-trivial, there was a significant amount of, you gave me a C, I'll give you a C, right? Which is, as I mentioned, even on the syllabus a long time ago, childish behavior. But there are some children, apparently, who may not be here, who may be here, okay, who are saying, I'm not going to look at the quality of your work, I'm just going to go, and give you a C. Oh, if you give me an A, oh, I love you too, right? And I had people come to me and complain that, number one, I had 3 essays that were all C. What do I do with that? I'm like, I'm sorry. I'm not going to grade your stuff, right? See, the thing is, oh, I'll look at it for you. No, that's not good, because then I get 80 people letting me help them. So if they're all similar, make a choice. Flip a coin. I don't care how you do it. When you write feedback, do your best to write feedback. And if someone gives you a crappy grade, I'm sorry. They're dumb. You're smart. They're dumb. Okay? If you get crappy feedback and you get 3 sets of crappy feedback, which one is the C? You have to figure it out. You have to give an A, even though they may not deserve it. I'm hoping, as usual, that on average, the mark that you get is more or less roughly proportional to the quality of the work you're putting in relative to your peers. There will be unfair situations. I've seen it. I will see it again. I'm sorry. But there's no other way to do this, except you have to grade 5 or 10 each. Now, if you want to grade 10 each, raise your hand. Oh, God. Okay, so let's stick with 3. So the law of averages, we hope, will work out. The briefing is about China. It is not about California. It is not about Coca-Cola in China. It's about resources and the environment in China. I said it fairly clearly in the briefing from your friend who's dad or uncle is the minister or something like that, or works at the ministry, at the Politburo, the Central Committee. So stay on topic. The video was appropriate. The chapters in Dolan, chapter 3 for sure. Chapter 3 is on pollution and the pricing system, which, by the way, is exactly what the briefing asked you to look at, right? You might want to read his little hints on how to use pollution and the pricing system. I realize that the deadlines are very tight, and if you're trying to do all the reading and write the briefing and do the editing, and then you know that's why you do the reading ahead of time. And chapter 4, he gets into collective action problems, which is part of the barrier to getting the reform into place, is that if it takes only a couple people to do the reform and it's opposed by a bunch of other people, then who wants to go first, right? If you go first in terms of proposing the reform, then you might be sticking your neck out. You might be taking a risk, and other people are going to wait for you to take the risk. And if you make it, great. And if you don't, then it's bad for you and it's okay for them. Collective action is a really huge problem when it comes to solving environmental issues. I noticed in there a very interesting discussion of how the Sierra Club, which is a big nature organization, the Sierra Club, how do they get their members to join with this collective action effort? The Sierra Club says, if you send us $100, we will use that to save the environment. Oh, but we will also give you a sticker that you can put on your car, on your SUV, right? We'll give you a sticker. We'll give you access to the newsletter. We'll take you on outdoor trips with experts who will give you guiding information. So the Sierra Club says, you should help us work on this collective action problem. Let me back up a second and define a collective action problem. It's that if it takes if it takes 10 units of effort to make a change that benefits 100 people, and one person puts in one unit of effort, which of the 10 of us are going to do it, right? That's a collective action problem. If it takes me one unit of effort to get one cup of coffee and I get to keep the cup of coffee, it's not a collective action problem, that's a market situation. I'm buying the coffee with my time, right? But if it's a public good or a collective good, then if I'm going to put in my effort and it's going to benefit everybody, then I might wait for you to put in the effort or you to put in the effort, and then I will benefit with no cost. Okay? So putting in effort has a cost. The benefit, the math is simple, right? Hey, cost benefit, we'll get there later. So if it costs a dollar and the benefit to me personally is 50 cents, then I don't have any incentive to do it, right? But if there's 10 of us, 10 times a dollar of effort produces, $20 of benefits. So this is a benefit, this is the cost. To be divided among 40 people, from a cost-benefit perspective, if we can find a way of spending $10 of effort and to create a benefit of $20 of benefit, then that's a good thing from a social perspective, right? Spend $10, make $20. But the benefit per individual is only, if there's 40 people, is only 50 cents each. So no individual wants to make that effort because the cost is a dollar, the benefit is 50 cents, right? And you have to find a way of doing it. The typical way of doing this, there's two ways. One of them is to say, I'm gonna tax everybody, $10 divided by 40, I'm gonna tax everybody a quarter of a dollar. If this is a tax of a quarter of a dollar, then I get $10 of revenue, so that's cost, and I can use the $10 of revenue to create $20 of benefit. So everybody ends up getting twice as much as they want. That's a political solution to a collective action problem. It works all the time, right? That's why we have police. That's why we have the fire department. That's why we have law and order and so on, right? So that's how it works in a society. We have a tax, but if it's voluntary and there's no tax, then you have to say, who are the 10 volunteers who will spend a dollar of their own time to get 50 cents of benefit? Well, no one wants to do that, right? It's hard to do. Some people will do it just because, oh, I feel like it's the right thing to do. So this is the center of the collective action problem, and the collective action problem is the center of environmental economics. Now, what the Sierra Club, who read the chapter remembers that Sierra Club thing? Okay, I'm not gonna give you a quiz, by the way, on this right now, but you should read it because it's really useful to understand these issues, and we will be going over them a lot. That's why I signed this book. That's why this book is now more important than it was before the midterm. So what the Sierra Club does is says, okay, look, you give me a dollar, and I will go lobby to create 50 cents of benefit, but I'll also give you a dollar of benefits as a member of the Sierra Club. It's the sticker, it's the newsletter, and so on, right? So what the Sierra Club does is they say, join our club, create collective benefits, but we'll give you some private benefits as well to make it attractive. And this is interesting to me because the governments in general do not like a challenge to their authority, okay? But in the United States, where there was a rebellion against the British, there in the Constitution of the United States, it says you can assemble in a group without fear of the police. It's the right of assembly, it's called. The right of assembly is like the Sierra Club. You guys all come together, you assemble, you go for a hike, but then you think, you know what, let's change government policy. While you're on your hike, you're changing government policy, right? And then you go back and you protest and you change something and you challenge the government. You challenge the laws, you say, this law is wrong, or I want you to enforce a law. So as a group, you're able to change the political environment. Now, of course, the party in China is not interested in that discussion, right? This is why the Falun Gong are very unpopular. It's not because of the meditation thing, right? It's because a group will come together for their personal benefit of the health and the exercise and so on, but then the leader of that group could say, hey, I got 20 million people who do this when I tell them to. And if I say to them, you know what, let's look at pollution problems, maybe they'll start looking at pollution problems a little bit more than the government wants, right? So this is the big stress. This is what happened with the, so I mentioned in the video, what happened in the video, the reforms of the 1980s, Deng's reforms, created a lot of social stress in China. And a lot of people got rich, but also a lot of people got corrupt. And the younger people said, oh my God, this is great, let's have democracy. We'll do like Europe. Well, I mean, this is, Tiananmen Square was 1989? Is that the year? 1989 was when the wall fell in Eastern Europe. My girlfriend is from Romania, right? She was, you know, her whole family was free of a communist dictatorship in 1989. So it's not like this was an isolated incident, what was going on in China and the world. The Soviet Union fell in 1991, and so on. So the party response that I brought up in this movie was not, the movie was not about... It wasn't about the controversy about Tiananmen Square. It wasn't about the government, like, oh, don't talk about it, right? The movie was about the change of the cycles, right? The ebb and the flow of I feel like my life is going well versus I'm not sure if I have anything going on in my life, right? And the response of the government was, well, we better figure out how to essentially make people rich because rich people don't protest. So the boost to economic reform was very beneficial in many, many ways. But the quid pro quo, which is openly discussed, is from the party will give you a material prosperity. You do not question the party's primacy, right? The party is in charge. And the reminder that I got from this Sierra Club example was, wow, that sounds like the Falun Gong. But it also is what's going on in China today. Right? The biggest source of challenge to the party in China is from environmental organizations, where people go and they, like in that movie, they walk along the river and they observe the river. And what's the next step they would do? They would say, hey, you know, in the Constitution of China, there's a law in China. There's people in jail in China right now who are saying, hey, you should enforce the laws. Right? That challenges the party's power. And that's not theoretical. This is not a classroom exercise, right? This is a fact. And that's very important in China today if there were no Chinese people in here, but it's important to you as individuals. There are other countries that have similar problems. Like you could go to Turkey, you can go to Egypt, you can go to South Africa. There's plenty of Brazil, huge problems, very similar problems in other countries. So I'm not saying that this is unique by any way to China. It's just very relevant, not just to you as individuals, but also to the briefing, right? So this process of collective action and organization and political reform and environmental provision of environmental goods is very, very relevant. In fact, it's so relevant that it's going to change all of our lives in terms of climate change. And right now, we can live in Vancouver, and we can breathe the air, and we can drink the water, and so on. There's little bits of issues with this in China, China and other countries. The blog post, by the way, a lot of blog posts are very good in terms of discussing these things. Not always the most clear discussion, but at least the discussion is going on. And the responses on the blog post are also very good. I'm glad to see various of you discussing these things. I'm glad I forced you to do it, but I hope you see that it's useful to learn from people and to discuss with them these ideas. So that's the climate change, what's going on in China right now, and what's going on, what went on in the U.S. in the 70s, but it's going on in Canada right now with their oil sands and water and pollution and so on. All of these things are going on everywhere in the world, and they're happening all the time, and that's one of the things that I want you to be very aware of, not just when you're in this class, but when you walk out of this class, saying, I understand more about how these dynamics work. And I'm at least I understand it, and if I'm going to work on that thing, which I've been doing, I personally have been working on these issues for 10 years, they're just, you know, crazy. They're crazy everywhere, right? But more people who understand means better for you, better for the world as a citizen. More action on understanding means a better chance of getting by, honestly. There is going to be, you know, if you look at the projections for climate change, no good news. Not even Canada, right? The red wine industry in Canada is not even going to be the good news, right? Because they'll be wiped out because the hurricanes or the tornadoes will move from Oklahoma up to Ontario, right? Or something ridiculous. So, and as far as climate change is concerned, just to give you a forecast, we're not doing anything to reduce the onset of climate change in terms of, you know, keeping carbon emissions down. So it's going to come, and then we're going to have to deal with it. That's called adaptation, okay? Adaptation also, guess what? Collective action problem. Because when there's a flood and it's taking out Calgary, you need to have neighbors who will pull you out of your basements and your flooded garages and so on. And if there's a flood and it's taking out New Orleans and there are no neighbors and there is no government, then you die. And climate change is all bad news. And it's going to be, unfortunately, getting worse over time. Right now, it's just like, oh gosh, you know, energy prices are high and so I had to pay a lot of money for heating. That's the big headlines from the United States. Oh no, I had to pay a lot of money for heating. It's like, you're lucky to be alive, right? You could turn on a switch and heat comes out of your house, right? These guys have no idea how bad life can be, right? Oh God, I have to pay another dollar. You know, oh, my sympathies. So, on that, I see you guys are all happy because of that mood. I'll try and cheer you up a little bit more. So, read the Dolan, chapters 3 and 4, more importantly 3, I think chapter 4 about population? 5, good, okay. And I assigned 2, 3, 4, 5. So you should have read 3 a little while ago. Read 4, if you feel like it, like look through it quickly to see if you're going to use it in your briefing, right? But we're really on topic as far as those chapters are concerned. And we'll get to 5 quite quickly. All right. Now, one thing I want to emphasize, I for some reason I didn't go through the explanation of the pop quiz, the answer for why the politician is... the question I asked was, why does the politician prefer a fuel economy standard for a car compared to a gasoline tax? And actually, since two out of 82 students in the class got that answer correct, I think I better explain the answer. Most people didn't get anything because they weren't here. Some people didn't read it, which is laudably honest. Some people didn't read it and tried to make an answer, which was still wrong, so they got 0 points, which is worse than nothing, so that was interesting. But that's what economics is all about. And the reason that the politicians want to have fuel economy standards compared to a gasoline tax is because they wanted to make the fuel efficiency goal of the government invisible. They don't want people to be thinking about fuel efficiency or, more importantly, about the government's role in fuel efficiency. They would just like to say, yeah, you have to buy a fuel-efficient car. You don't really know how much it's going to change the cost of the car, but that's how the government's going to enforce fuel efficiency. A gasoline tax, which is actually more efficient and more fair, would be very visible, right? In this country, you get your bill. If you go buy something at the store, they tell you the total. I'm mixing up the United States and Canada. If I go buy shoes at the store for $99.99, and I go to buy it at the till, they put tax on top of that, right? Okay, so this is borrowed from the United States, and there's some long excuse about why it's about, you know, because the taxes change from place to place, the GST, the PST, the VAT, the sales tax, whatever it is. So there's some idea like $99.95 all the way across the country, and the tax will vary from place to place. Reasonable, but the Europeans have figured this out a million years ago. And if you go and you pay 100 euros for the boots, you give them 100 euros, you're done. There's no taxes because the taxes are included in the price. But in North America, we're going to have the tax separate so that you, the consumer, the citizen, know the government burden on you. That's really one of the big reasons why taxes are separated. It drives me crazy because I can't remember anything. I'm like, oh, it's $99, I got 100, I can do that. No, I need $12 or $15, whatever the hell it is. So it's supposedly the taxes are kept separate so you know what the burden is. Supposedly the burden is separate so that you, the citizens, will rebel against the government because the taxes are so high. Now, I don't know, when you go buy a cup of coffee or you buy a pair of shoes, I don't know if you're thinking rebellion or you're thinking I want to buy these shoes, but that is the excuse for separating out the taxes. The example that I had on the pop quiz is exactly the same thing. The taxes that are visible scare politicians. They don't want you to see that they are costing you something, right? It's a little bit of an immature conversation. Children, you can have cookies, you can have milk, but you don't have to pay for anything. That's essentially what the politicians are saying. Whereas most of us understand, when we go buy a cup of coffee, we've got to pay money. If we have to buy a pair of shoes, we've got to pay money. If we want to drive our car, we've got to pay money. But the political calculus is to not do that. And that's only the shallow excuse, right? The very deep excuse is that either the government doesn't want you to use less gasoline, right? Which is the whole cigarettes in China problem. Cigarettes are bad, please smoke, because we need the tax revenue. So either they don't want you to change your behavior, or the oil and gas and automobile industries don't want you to change your behavior, and they control the government, and that's how the government puts in an unresponsive policy, right? So there is a reason why this stupid process is the process, and it's not about economic efficiency, and it is probably about political expediency or political lobbying, as well as corruption or selling more cars or more gasoline. I'll finalize my comments on the gasoline mileage to say that when the United States put their mileage requirements into place, the lobbying from the car company said, you don't look at our worst car like a big, you know, a Hummer. You don't look at the Hummer. You have to look at all of our cars across our fleet of cars and take the average. It's called, in the U.S., it's called corporate average fuel economy. So General Motors takes all of their 50 cars, and they take the average fuel economy of those cars, and that is the level that the government requires them to meet. So if you have big cars, you just have to have a couple small cars. And I believe, by the way, it's not on the number, the volume of cars sold, it's just that the existence of the car that's available for sale. So that you make one small car and you can sell a whole bunch of, you know, the U.S. car makers, they make huge trucks and all kinds of big, big, big cars because they make huge money on them, and Americans are big and they want to drive big cars, big places with big people. And Canadians, and they have a couple small cars just to get the corporate average fuel economy. Now what's interesting about this, besides that it's retarded, is that the Japanese car makers and now the Korean car makers and the Chinese now coming in car, they almost always start off with small cars. Because Honda started with motorcycles, right? And they probably want lawnmowers and motorcycles, then they go into a little teeny car. The little Honda was as big as this table, you know, when it first came out. It was smaller than a Smart. And so the Japanese car makers had these little cars that were super efficient, because Japan's a little place and they have to park in little places and all that stuff, and the petrol is more expensive and everything. But when the United States made this law, Toyota and Nissan and Honda, they said, well, wait a second. The standard we have to hit is 28 miles per gallon, so whatever that is. In Canada, you guys use miles per gallon? Or you have to do like 15 liters per 100 kilometers. It was something really like very inefficient. And the Japanese are like, we're already at 12 liters per 100 kilometers. why don't we make some big cars? Because it only has to be an average. So the law in the United States to help improve fuel efficiency led Japanese car makers to bring out inefficient cars because they could make money and exploit the market share because the Americans couldn't make more and more bigger cars. So the law to save fuel wastes more fuel. If you go to the US today and you look at SUVs, a whole bunch of them are Toyota Land Cruisers and all these other bigger and bigger cars. You know, the names are the Tundra and the Seizure and the whatever and the space planet travel thing. They have these names which are bigger and bigger and bigger and strong. Iron Tundra, you know, whatever it is. You're going to go get some groceries in your Iron Tundra. So the law, which was supposed to be about the visible reduction of fuel economy, created an invisible, they made it invisible, and then it resulted in this ridiculous expansion of market share for huge cars, the United States. So in some ways, you can actually say it made it worse than nothing at all, which is mind-boggling, but not unusual as far as this topic is concerned. Always entertaining. Okay, so that's the visible-invisible. The politician wants to, in some ways, the politician wants to, there's an expression from the French court, the art of taxation is to pluck the feathers from the goose, you know, the bird. You take as many feathers as you can from the bird without the bird making noise. So you want to very quietly take your money away. That's what taxation is all about. And the government wants to very quietly have a fuel economy standard, but they don't want you to know that we're trying to get you to use less fuel, which is a bit retarded, because if they tell you, hey, use less fuel, maybe you'll think, maybe I should use less fuel. Right? You'll shift in your demand curve instead of working on the price mechanism or going to buy a new car. Okay. Cost-benefit analysis. What I want to do is I want to build up cost-benefit analysis from some basic stuff in economics, and then I want to merge that into the whole jobs are costs or jobs are benefits discussion, right? Are pipelines good for Canada from economic impact analysis, or are they good for the world, and so on? Okay, I want to take these things and I want to merge them together so that you see that how they fit together. And this is relevant because I want you to see how cost-benefit analysis depends on where you're standing, right? Are you a worker who is unemployed? That job is a benefit, right? Are you an employer who is being told to hire somebody because of a law? That job is a cost, right? Are you the country of Canada that has job growth because of pipelines? Those jobs are benefits, and so on, so that we can go through and say, why does this job go from being a cost to a benefit to a cost, right, when we're talking about cost-benefit? Most importantly, as an economist doing cost-benefit analysis, you should go to the largest possible scale, which is what Chris pointed out in his talk last Thursday. The largest possible scale is when you include all the costs and all the benefits. Negative externalities are costs. Positive externalities are benefits. When you do a proper cost-benefit analysis, then you include those things in there. And that is how you think like an economist. If you don't include them in there, then you're thinking like a lobbyist. What you're trying to do is hide some costs and push forward your benefits, right? Or you say, oh, we're going to have this many jobs, and we're not going to talk about the pollution, but it's going to generate a lot of tax revenue, and I'm not going to tell you about my profits, right? So people lie with cost-benefit analysis. What I want you to do is to know when they're lying, and when you do your cost-benefit analysis, you're going to do it completely, and then I'll say, okay, now, I want you to lie as if you're from the oil industry. And then you'll say, okay, I'm going to move this out. I'm going to change this over here. And then you're going to be good at lying, which I don't want you to really learn how to do. But I want you to learn where the lie is. Because if you're going to do economic analysis, if you're actually going to graduate from here and someone's going to say, hey, do a cost benefit on this project, you're going to say, I wonder if I have all the costs and all the benefits. This will be a significant win when you can do that. All right. Let's talk about the very simple thing before we take the break. The first thing that you learned, I think, a long time ago, is that there's trade-offs between two goods. Coffee, for example, and donuts, my favorite. If this was an afternoon class, it would be beer and chips, okay? So we're doing coffee and donuts because it's the morning. Let's say you guys remember those preferences? Okay? Those are perfect substitutes or complements? Complements. Okay. Then we have the perfect substitutes one. It's an even trade-off. You don't care. You're totally indifferent. You could have total donuts and zero coffee and so on, right? These are perfect substitutes. They're perfect complements. But most indifference curves are like this. Would you prefer to be on A or B? B, right? B is more of everything. That's why B is better. Has anybody not seen or does not remember these indifference curves? I seriously want to know. There is no quiz. I want to make sure that you know what I'm talking about here. The indifference curves are showing bundles. You're at bundles that you are indifferent to. I am indifferent to this bundle and this bundle. I am willing to trade this much coffee and this many donuts. I'll have less coffee and more donuts. If you reduce my coffee and you give me more donuts, I'm okay with that. I'm indifferent to that. My utility is the same. Okay? This is what we do when we're talking about trade-offs between goods. Now, wait a second. Trade-offs. If I have five coffees and I go to three coffees and I go from, let's go big here, eight donuts to 15 donuts. So if you take away, or if I take away two coffees from you, I take you from five to three, I have to give you how many extra donuts? Seven extra donuts. So if I take away two coffees, the two coffees are a cost or a benefit? Costs. I take away two coffees and I give you a benefit of seven, right? More to 15 total. What if I give you eight donuts? Good deal or bad deal? Good deal, right? Because I'm going to end up on a higher indifference curve. The benefit is worth the cost. It's worth it. It's a trade-off. It's a trade-off I would take. These are the words that we use to talk about cost-benefit in terms of our decision-making. Right? Cost-benefit analysis is how we balance out those things, or we add them up. Because in the end, when you do a cost-benefit analysis, you're trying to figure out, should I make this decision or not? Should I make this move, take this action or not? That is the foundation of cost-benefit analysis. This is why it's critical, it's central to economics, right? If you're going to take away some and give some, that's okay. Now, what we do on the next step is we start to say, well, the next step is we have an indifference curve, and then we have a budget constraint that's based on two things. Income, or M, you might depends on how you've seen it, equals P coffee times coffee plus P donut times donut, right? You spend all your money on those two goods. The slope of the budget constraint is based on the relative prices. You expend all your money buying as much as you possibly can to get on the highest indifference curve possible. right? You're not interested in being down here when you have that kind of money, right? You go all the way up to here and you get the very badly drawn tangency, right? So you're point A. But now we have a thing called money. We've just introduced money into this discussion. And then what ends up happening is you say, okay, I've got $10 equals 1 times 5 plus cost, 1 half times 10. So I've got 10 donuts at 50 cents each. I've got 5 coffees at $1 each. That adds up to 10, right? Now, where it gets interesting here is we brought in money, and we're talking about money and donuts and coffee. So if I say, what are you going to do to get another coffee? You say, I'm going to spend some money. But what we talk about is saying, I'm going to have less donuts. If I want another coffee, I got to get 2 less donuts to get 1 coffee. That's the coffee-donut exchange rate right now. So the opportunity cost of a coffee is 2 donuts, or in a way, I could give you $1, and you could also get a coffee. So the cost-benefit is the same discussion. If you want another coffee, either you get $1, or you give up 2 donuts. And what happens very quickly is we stop talking about buying coffee with donuts, we start talking about buying coffee with money. Do you see that? We start using money as a shorthand for donuts, basically. But if you walk outside in the quad and you're saying, I want to have some lunch, I'm going to get a salad, I'm going to get a drink, I'm going to get a hot dog, how many donuts is that going to cost me? You don't think in terms of donuts anymore. You think in terms of money, dollars, Canadian dollars. But maybe you're from another country and you think, how many Canadian dollars is that? Oh, how much is that in my home country, right? Does anybody still think in your home currency? Sometimes, it's like, you'll think in your home currency, I guarantee it, if you go get a job or if you buy a house, right? Because you'd be like, holy cow, right? Because you don't want to know what these numbers are in the local currency. It doesn't make any sense because all of your references are based on your home currency, right? What you grew up with. And after a while, you don't care how much a soup costs or a beer costs or whatever, because you have to buy a beer. But when you switch countries, I've traveled to over 90 countries, right? Every time you switch countries, you're like, oh, how much does a beer cost? And you get a ratio sometimes. You know, it's like you get 4 beers will buy you a dinner, or 10 beers will buy you a bed. You know, there's these kind of strange things. But we're back to coffee donuts in terms of the way the economy works. Those ratios are always out there, but we use dollars as a shorthand. Or we use currency as a shorthand to understand the trade-offs. So when I say, what's the benefit of coffee? You're like, coffee is the benefit, right? What's the cost? $2 or $3 or whatever it is. But it's really donuts, or it's really the other things that you could do, right? More importantly, it's like, how do you make the money in the first place to get to the coffee? Usually you do that by working, right? So, after the break, we'll take a 10-minute break.
A
couple questions came up on the break that I want to answer about the briefings to clarify. First one is that in the briefing, I don't remember the exact wording, but I use the word come up with a policy or create a policy or whatever. A policy is a very big word that means many different things. So, with a policy, you can make a regulation, you can make a tax, you can make a penalty, you can educate people. We have an educational policy. So you can come up with anything that is to address the problem. It can be an idea that you import from another part of China. It can be an idea you import from another country. It can be an idea that you just made up with your friends while you were having a drink. Okay? What your policy should be doing, if I'm not getting the briefing incorrectly, what it should be doing is addressing the problem, right? It should be improving on the problem. I suggest you just come up with one and you talk about this one will improve matters. It may not solve all the world's problems. You only have 1,000 words to solve the world's problems, okay? So don't worry about that. Yeah. Thank God. Okay. Uh-huh. For example, you can create regulations or property rights, but they must be used. Okay. But those must then be used with economic instruments. So if you create a regulation saying, what is this about? It's going to be a resource problem. So say the problem is gasoline consumption. I'm going to create a regulation saying your cars can only drive 50 kilometers an hour between Beijing and Shanghai. That's the regulation. Good regulation, right? No fuel economy. Everybody would be taking their bicycles. It'll be faster. But that's a regulation, but there's no market there, right? So if you create the regulation, say, there's no pricing there. It's like, the regulation is that you can go 50 kilometers an hour between Beijing and Shanghai, but if you want to go 10 kilometers an hour faster, you have to pay whatever, 10 RMB per 10 kilometers. Every kilometer an hour you want to go fast, you pay 1 RMB. So you can go 150 kilometers an hour, but you have to pay 100 RMB per whatever that is, hour, something like that. That's a kind of a regulation with a market mechanism. Okay? So don't just say the regulation is you're going to be nice. Say we're going to have a cap and trade of nice, and 20 of you get to be nice, but you have to pay for the privilege or something like that. Bring money in there somehow. That's probably the easiest way to think about it. Okay. Another thing that came up, so I said, for example, use prices or markets. Describe the transaction costs for implementing the policy. And I said needed data. What I mean by needed data is the data that you would need if you were put in charge of this and someone gave you a huge budget. Don't go looking for data. You don't need data to write the briefing. I want you to say, what data would you need if you wanted to do your policy? So if I want to do a policy about tailpipe emissions and I want to have a cap and trade that every car has a limit per thing, then I'm going to need to have the data for the exhaust coming out of every car, right? It may never exist, but I want you to say what you need, okay? So don't go get data, just tell me the kind of data that you would need. Along the same lines, the enforcement agency, is there an enforcement agency? I don't care what the name is. No one cares what the name is. I need an enforcement agency for my regulation. The enforcement agency would have to have power over air quality and car drivers and within the province or across the country or whatever. You would just discuss it, right? You don't have to say how many employees they would have or anything like that. Just say what they would do, okay? Now, transaction costs are what I talk about here, and I'll just define them. Transaction costs are costs that are part of the transaction but are not directly in the transaction. So if I go to Starbucks and I buy a coffee, they say it's $3 for the coffee. I take the $3 in my pocket and I give it to them. There are zero transaction costs until I start counting them up. I have to walk to Starbucks. I have to wait in line. So I might have to, I have a transportation, I have a delay, I've got to have change. If I don't have change, then I have to have a card. If I don't have that, I have another transaction cost, go find a friend, borrow some money from them. Then I come back. Then they put the card, then there's some time waiting for the card to go. The card transaction, maybe they charge me 1% as a transaction fee. Transaction cost, transaction cost, transaction cost. The $3 coffee is very simple, but all of the stuff I have to do to get the $3 coffee is a transaction cost. You came to class today, you had to get out of bed, you had to get your clothes on, you had to come to school. I mean, anybody who slept here, fine, but you had to do all that stuff. Those are all transactions, right? I put the video on the internet. It takes 2 hours for processing the video. It takes 20 minutes to upload the video. I've got to rename the video. Those are all. I don't just say video internet. There's a transaction cost. I have to do a bunch of steps to get there. The easiest thing to think about when you're thinking about transaction costs is, if I was going to do this right now, what would I have to do? Right? I'd have to get a building. I'd have to put people in the building. I'd have to staff it up. I'd have to write a regulation. I'd have to start a law on January 1st. I'd have to announce it on October 1st. There's a whole bunch of steps that are involved with doing anything. Don't get too detailed, but just think about what would be important. If you talk about transaction costs, talk about the three most important transaction costs. Okay, or three, right? Talk about the three most important transaction costs affecting your policy. This is the advice to you in the room. I'm not going to send on email, so this is important. When you're writing it and when you're grading it, make sure that there's three transaction costs that are listed for your policy. And it doesn't have to be very complicated. Say, I'm going to need this information, or I'm going to need to set up a division to accept tax revenue, or I'm going to have to keep a record of who owns what in terms of a cap and trade. At least three. You could do more, but just make sure you specify a few things that are important. Those are transaction costs, okay? Transaction costs end up being the difference between a good policy and a bad policy. It's quite, the United States tax code is considered one of the worst in the entire world because of the unbelievable transaction costs. Like, I have to do my taxes in the near future, which I'm, can't wait, right? But they have, it's crazy. It's literally, crazy people would be more rational than what we have in the U.S. with the tax code. And it takes me, I have to go through six forms and read three booklets and do six cross references and two double check tables. And they have software, by the way, to already help you do this, but it gets worse, right? Did you take the number of this divided by the number of that, and it's just nuts, right? The US tax code is so painful that 95% of Americans don't do their taxes. They pay, but they pay someone else to do their taxes. So there are millions of people in the United States who help people file their taxes because the tax code is so ridiculous. And from a political economy standpoint, do those tax accountants like the tax code or hate the tax code? They like it. That's job security, right? The United States Congress creates jobs. Every time they make the tax code more ridiculous, they create more jobs for tax accountants. Right? Job creators. They always talk about the government can create jobs. That's one really bad example of how the government creates jobs. They create jobs by creating transaction costs, and people who are trying to avoid the transaction costs will pay $100, $200, $300. Please, you do my taxes. I do my taxes, number one, because I'm cheap, but number two, I want to understand how exactly screwed up this system is. And it's just like, this is a good reason why I'm leaving the United States. And it's like, if you want to have I do my taxes in Dutch, by the way, when I was in the Netherlands, and I have to do it again this year. I don't speak Dutch. I can do my taxes in Dutch in 10% of the time that I could do it in the United States. I just do Google Translate. What does this mean? Oh, give us money. Okay, I know what that means, right? So transaction costs matter. In the article that I emailed to you last night, the Paris versus Beijing was the subject line. It was a very interesting example of a very fast, totally unfair, but low transaction cost solution. Paris is facing record pollution. I'm not sure what their record is compared to Beijing's average. But basically they said, if you have a car with a license plate that ends with a one or an odd number, you can drive on an odd day. Even number, you can drive on an even day. They just cut the car population in half. Unless it's really important. Seriously, you pay a fine. You have to pay a $30 fine. If it's really important, you just drive your car. Here's the money. You keep driving your car, right? Or there's three people in the car, so they're trying to reduce the number of people in the cars. Or, I don't know, some other thing. But that is a very fast policy to put in place to reduce the traffic on the roads. And all public transportation is free, which is a good way to get people to drive or get on the metro and get on the buses and so on. So that's a very interesting example of how the French are dealing with a very local pollution problem. I think it was a fascinating example, very good example of economics in that. So speaking of policies, I talked about that, right? Did I talk about the policies in the briefing? Did I? So I took the printout. Where's the printout of the briefing? Who had that? Is that you? So someone said on the break, what do you mean by policy? Suggest one resource problem. Describe an economic policy to fix the problem, right? Policies include everything. Regulations are policies, right? A policy is a big word that it means many things. Am I repeating myself? Did I say that? I am. I'm just crazy. You should have told me I already repeated myself. You guys have jobs. You have responsibilities here. I'm just like wandering in circles. Okay. So is that enough? Do we anything else on the briefing? No? Okay. So meanwhile, we get back to cost-benefit analysis. And you're sitting there deciding to yourself, oh my God, I want to go to class because I can't wait to hear all about economics, but I have to get out of bed to get to class, right? Benefit is what? What's the benefit? The benefit is you get to go to class. Come on, you guys. The cost is got to get out of bed. Now, of course, we do know that if you went to bed at 8 o'clock last night, you would be awake at 4 o'clock in the morning, you'd be out of bed, right? But, of course, if you went to bed at 8 o'clock last night, you wouldn't be chatting with your friends, you wouldn't be watching the movies, you wouldn't be whatever, drinking and stuff like that, or, of course, studying, right? So, benefit cost. Class. Woohoo! Okay. Sleep. Right? You've got to give up on sleep to get... And I have the same problem, by the way. Don't think that I love this 8:30 stuff. So the benefit is you're having a trade-off. You have an exchange, the benefit cost. And it's not obvious how to, in some ways, just as a footnote, it's not obvious how to measure that, right? You're coming to class because you think, okay, I might learn something, or okay, I might get a better grade, or okay, I'm going to, be a good student. There's all kinds of stuff. It's very mushy. You don't necessarily know the values of these things, right? And the same thing with sleep. It's like, I'm sleeping, I'm awake, I'm already awake. Crap, I might as well go to class because I woke up. Because if I sit here and I'm not in class, then it's gonna, and I don't want to watch the video anyway because I'd rather do something else. Now, we do know from the revealed preference perspective that this cost-benefit analysis switched the other way for some people, right? If you're here, this is you. If you're not here, this is them, right? So there is a cost-benefit calculation going on. If this was if Justin Bieber was up here doing his stuff or whatever, it would be full, right? Maybe not with you, but it would be full, right? So that's the cost-benefit thing. Now, it's not monetary. Let's say now, you say, forget class. I'll give you a job for $20 an hour. Now you're like, okay, wait. I can make $20 an hour. Say that you're doing something like you're, whatever, making coffee. Something reasonably easy to do. No mental labor, no mental stress. $20 an hour, you're getting some cash. Now you can go back to that coffee donut economy and start buying coffee and donuts. And now you're saying, okay, sleep versus $20 an hour. And at some point, or even worse. Now let's ignore the whole point. If you don't show up at work, you get fired. Important, right? Because then it's like it's not $20 an hour. It's an entire career of $20 an hour getting fired or that particular job. But you have this calculation. You're like, cost benefit. $20 an hour versus sleeping. So now you're looking at money against sleeping. The opportunity cost of earning $20 an hour is what? Sleeping. Right? And if it's not that bad, if you're already awake, then it's like, hey, it's not such a big cost. Yeah, okay, you got to do the transaction cost. You got to get out of bed. You got to get your clothes on. You got to get to work and so on. Just the same as always. Now you've got your $20 an hour job, and someone says, hey, do you want to work for $30 an hour doing the same job? Now, on the one hand, I'm not trying to make this tricky, but on the one hand, what's the opportunity cost of the $30 an hour job? Huh? $20 is the opportunity. You have to give up one thing to get the other thing, right? I give up some coffee to get a donut. I give up $20 job hour job to get a $30 an hour job. It's a little bit weird that maybe the opportunity cost is sleeping because it's the same job. But in some ways, what you have to look at is your next best alternative. If you already got out of bed, and you're at your $20 an hour job, then the opportunity cost for the $30 an hour job is the $20 an hour job. If you're still in bed and you have the $30 an hour job, now you're back to sleep versus $30 an hour, right? You have to look at your next best alternative. What if this job has a small chance of losing a finger? Because you're working with high-speed coffee grinding machinery. You might lose a finger or four. Is that a cost or a benefit, the fingers? It's a cost. But you need to calculate the total and say, how do I feel about $20 an hour with all my fingers and $30 an hour with a non-trivial risk of losing my finger? So that is the, all this ends up going into is this goes into your whole discussion of benefits, and it's a net, you're looking at a net benefit. If I go work on an oil rig and I'm making $80 an hour drilling oil, but every once in a while a guy loses his hand because some machine rips it off, you'll find it later, right? You can wear it around your neck, a little hand, right? So that's why do guys, young guys, go into these catching fish and driving trucks overnight and oil rigs? Because guys are like, risk, whatever, I'm getting a whole bunch of money. Women are like, I think I like my hands and limbs and stuff like that, right? So women are less risk seeking in some ways than men. So that calculation ends up being a personal weight between those two things in terms of, is this really a benefit? You put your own risk on that. So you are looking at costs and benefits, right? I could do this to the rest of class. You say, should I stay in school? I have a cost. I'm spending 4 years of my life in here. The benefit is knowledge, of course. We all love knowledge for the sake of knowledge, but you can sit on the beach and read books. Or you can go down to the bar and talk to the drunk guy. You can get knowledge from that way, too. But you're in school because you want to have a more formal knowledge. Maybe you could have a network or whatever. That's fine. But the idea is that you're going to go through this, spend time and money, and you're going to come out with more knowledge and more education, which will help you in your life and help you with your work. And your work is two things. One is it makes you some money, which helps you buy all the goodies that you like. And the other one is it's something that you are doing which makes you feel good. Because if I say, take a shitty job for double the money, you might be working for double the money, but after a while you're like, you know, I don't think I really like this job, even with double the money. Right? I had students all the time, they said, oh, all I want to do is make money. I'm like, good, go be a prostitute. It's simple, right? Why is not every person out there being a prostitute? I mean, supply and demand, that'd be crazy, right? Because the price of prostitution would drop through the floor. But it isn't just about the money. You're doing the job because you want to work in a particular area, or you want to do a particular kind of work, or you want to, I don't know, there's a whole bunch of reasons. Very often, because you've seen someone you know do that job, right? Most of us end up at some point working in an area where our parents have worked, right? I did it in my own life, and you're like, you check it out, it's like, okay, I'm familiar with this, and then I'll check it out, it's like, I like it or I don't like it, right? So you like work, we like work for more than just the money, and we more than just the time. We do work for all kinds of reasons. But now that's you, and let's say that you have a benefit of $30 an hour and your fingers for a good job, and a cost is going to be time. Right? Time is the most obvious cost to you. And time in economics, we use time as a kind of a currency, right? We spend our time doing things. I spend my time teaching you, I spend my time writing a book or blogging or whatever, right? So I have $30 an hour versus time, and if the benefits are greater than the cost, I take that job. Now what, let's say that's you. Now let's say your employer comes along and they look at $30 an hour. Where does that go? For the employer, $30 an hour is a cost or a benefit? Cost, right? Why would they hire you? What? Create value. How much value? More than 30. I sure hope so. It's more than 30. 40, 42, 50, who cares? Right? It's more than 30. The employer's decision is, are you going to produce profits to me that are more than $30 of your cost? This is a for-profit employer, right? This is not the government giving jobs to their friends. In fact, if it's the government giving jobs to your friends, if this is I'm using the word government in the sense of a wasteful government job, which is a bit of a stereotype, but it happens. But why do wasteful government jobs exist more than wasteful private sector jobs? Not you. I'll ask you. Why would have you ever heard of anybody working in the government with a job where they do no work and they get ridiculous money? No. Have you know this film? You do, okay. No, don't name any names. Why could that persist? Why would that happen in the first place? I mean, I know the person is very happy to have, you know, good money, do nothing at all. They like that. That's a benefit for the employee, secure. But why does the employer hire that person who is not doing very much work and getting paid very well? Exactly right, right? So the $30 is, it depends who is it from, right? Now we start to get into the really complicated discussion of whose costs and whose benefits, right? When you are doing a cost-benefit analysis, you want to take all the costs and all the benefits and then compare them to each other, but you don't want to speak who has what, who gets what. But all of those individuals are very interested in who gets what, right? So this is taxpayer money. If it's not profit, loss, or waste, then no one really cares whether this is $30, whether the money is earned. No one cares what that is because this is tax money and it's someone else's burden. This is a political discussion all the time, right? But that's why it's more common to see wasteful or it's more common to see useless employees working for a bureaucracy than it is to see them in a for-profit, because the bureaucracy is funded from tax revenue and the for-profit is funded by sales, and the manager or the entrepreneur who's managing the for-profit doesn't want to waste his or her money on useless employees. The smaller the business, the more likely this is true, right? If you have a family running a grocery store or a cafe, everybody is working to produce the profits. If it's a family and they have the kids that are working there, the kids, maybe they're breaking stuff and whatever, but the family's like, number one, I don't have to get a babysitter. Number two, you're hanging out with us and we love you. Number three, you're learning about the business, and when you're 15, you can run the whole place. Right? That's how kids grow into the business. So the parents say, looking forward, this will be profitable. As the family-owned business expands, let's bring in the brother, let's bring in the cousin. They're going to do the brother and the cousin usually because they are worried about the quality of the work that they're going to get for the money they pay. As soon as you bring in an outsider, the outsider's like, dude, I'm making $30 an hour and I'm doing as little work as possible. Right? That is when the business is going to be upset about the output. That's when your business has to become more formalized and you have to think, you have systems, you have to punch in, you have to check in what time you come in, you have to check in what time you come out, you have to show your work records and all kinds of stuff. Bureaucracy grows with the business because they're trying to make sure they're getting the benefits against the costs. Because if you get to a big enough company, you'll have people who are doing this, they're worthless employees, and not because of tax revenue, but because the company is just paying them a salary and they can't measure their productivity. That's just so you know, because we're working in the employment discussion right now about cost benefit, but that's what happens at businesses. And bigger businesses have bigger problems, and the government really is one of the biggest businesses in the world. That's why they have huge problems with their employment productivity. So now you can see that from the employer perspective, let's ignore this government side thing. From the employer's perspective, from your perspective, you're giving your time, you're getting the money. This is a wash, right? This is a transfer, so it doesn't count. And the profits are there. From a social perspective, you're giving up time and society is getting profits or output, right? And by profit, I mean like profitable output. You're producing $45 of value in terms of customers or productivity or whatever you want to call it, surplus. The surplus diagram, in fact, is like this. Supply of labor, demand for labor. Here's the price, $30. The employer will hire you if you're producing surplus. This is your surplus, which is the time. Your time cost is underneath the curve here. This is the benefit that's greater than your time cost. And so you're happy to take that job because you're getting a surplus. The employer is getting the surplus. From a social perspective, this is a good deal. This is how you match cost benefit to supply and demand curve to surplus. This is the center of what I wanted to get to today, right? About what's going on with benefits. It turns out that these numbers are very hard to calculate because I don't know what the cost of time is. I just take it for granted that if you're here, it's worth spending your time. Right? If you go to work and you get paid $30, it's worth spending your time. If they employ you with $30, it's worth their money. But from an economic perspective, we say, oh yeah, it's this shaded area. If you wanted to do the accounting and go ask people, that's very, very hard. You, in some ways, you don't even know your own cost of time, right? You just say, nah, I'd rather do that. That's all you need to do anyway, right? The worst thing that happens is, you make a decision to do that, and then you realize someone tells you later on, oh, you could have gone there. Shoot. Now, have you ever had that thing where you missed whatever it is? Like, I didn't know that was happening. I totally would have gone there if I knew. I didn't know I could have gotten that job. I would have applied for it or whatever, right? So from a cost-benefit analysis, we've got some idea of time and some idea of profits, but all we're seeing is the $30. That's changing hands. So if we're doing a benefit cost for this thing here, then in a sense we have to put time and profits as the benefit and the cost, as the summary, because the middle part is just a transfer. Now, what if you're what if this company that's hiring you for $30 an hour, We can quantify this sometimes. Let's say the company is going to hire you for $30 an hour and they're going to build a pipeline. And the pipeline is going to move for oil and it's going to create $100 of profits and it's going to have a cost.
If I was going to do everything with time, I'd have to say, okay, what's the capital expenditure? What's the annual expenditure? You know, CapEx and OpEx, and then we'd have to look at annual wages and then we'd have to look at annual revenues and say, let's use a discount rate and all that stuff. That is not what I want to talk about right now. That's totally relevant, but I don't want to talk about that right now. Let's say the profit is going to make $100 a profit. It's going to cost $50 in parts and labor. Okay? So, benefit 100, cost 50, right? Benefit costs. The benefit from the pipeline owner is not oil. It's the money from selling the pipeline transportation services to the oil company. That's the $100. The oil pipeline company does not care about the price of oil, really. They care about moving oil. If you ever talk about to financial planners, financial stockbrokers or whatever, anybody have a family in the financial business? Stockbrokers don't care if the market goes up or goes down. They just care that you trade shares. As long as you trade stuff, they make money. If the price goes down, you trade, they make money. The price goes up, you trade, they make money. Pipeline companies don't care about the price of oil. They care about moving the oil. That's why some of the pipelines in Canada and around the U.S. are being reversed. They used to go this way, now they're going that way. Right? All the pumps are going the other direction now because they can still make money. They're just making money on moving the oil. They don't care about the price. They don't care about the oil production. They don't care about consumers driving their cars. They don't care about carbon. Just care about the money. So this is a good deal as far as the pipeline is the pipeline company is concerned. From a social perspective, this is from the company. Sorry. This is Company A. Company A has that perspective. Now, let's look at Company B. There's this new pipeline that we can use. It's going to cost $100 to... this is more like revenue, by the way, but profits. It's the same thing. It's going to cost $100 to use that pipeline, but then we can sell our oil for $200 more because the pipeline will take oil from where it's at one price and to another place where it's at a higher price and we'll make a $200 profit. Company B, benefit cost. $100 a cost to use the pipeline, or $100 to use the pipeline, cost or benefit? Cost. What's a better deal? I mean, not what's a better deal. Is it a good deal? Yeah, benefit's greater than cost. Now, wait a second. Where are we looking at? What are we looking at socially now? What's the benefits and costs of this whole idea of doing a pipeline? What's the cost from a social perspective? 50. What's the benefit? What's the benefit from a social perspective? Nope. Not very many numbers. Try again. 100 plus 100. Right? Because the additional profit of moving the oil from where it's cheap to where it's valuable, that's the $200 benefit to that company. Right? They're willing to pay $100 to get it. But social means we have to add A plus B. So we have a cost of $50 to build a pipeline, and we have a benefit of $200 of additional revenue. Because the company, and the $100 is a wash. Now, if the company, the oil pipeline company, could hire more workers to watch that pipeline at a cost of $20, is that a good idea? Is it a good idea for the company to hire some more workers at a cost of $20 to watch the pipeline? Why is it a good idea? Okay, so still your benefits are greater than your costs, but what's the marginal benefit of those additional workers? The marginal cost is, what's the marginal benefit? Wait, let me help you out. I mean, they're still making money, but that's like not a good business deal, right? It's like saying, you're making $50 of profits. How about you make $20 of profits or $30 of profits, right? 50 is better than 30. So the employer, the company, Company A, is not interested in more employees unless they can produce more money. If you hire more workers and they reduce pipeline oil theft, whatever you want to call it, right? Big problem in Nigeria. You hire more workers, they cost you 20, but you make 30, good deal, right? Marginal benefit, 30, marginal cost, 20. Jobs, this is my big tagline, right? Jobs are a cost. Jobs are a cost. It's not worth having more workers unless you're going to get the benefit. So let's ignore them for a second. So here we have Company A, Company B, social calculus right now. This is looking pretty good. Yes? Mm-hmm. Well, it could be, but I've got benefit of 100 plus 200 and costs of 50 plus 100. So that's the wash. The 100 cancel each other out. Okay, now, but social. There's two other things that are not here in social. The easiest one to think about is, oh my God, the government says, you guys are making some pretty good money on the oil pipelines. Let's tax you a little bit. Okay, we're going to take $50 of taxes off of the oil exporting company. We'll allow the pipeline company to get away with this because, you know, it's my cousin who runs that company. So $50 of taxes, no benefit. We don't have the government here yet, do we? Now the government's got a benefit and a cost. At zero costs, the government gets $50 of taxes. Is society better off or worse off? What was that noise over there? Same? Better, worse? Hold on. Is the government better off or society better off? Society is better off or worse off? Or the same? Same. Society's the same. Now I bring the government in here. Benefit, where's the social, right? So I'll just do it all here. 100, 100, those cancel, right? I got 50, this is, sorry, 50 of costs, right? 50 of costs and $50 of benefit. Wash. Right? They don't count. Now, if you're from the government and someone just gives you $50 and you had zero, it's clearly better, you're better off as the government. What I'm saying here is that the benefit cost discussion changes depending on if you're the government, the company, or the employee, right? But from a social perspective, as economists talking about cost-benefit analysis, we want to keep track of that. This is where all the action is. This is what matters. Now, theoretically, the government can spend the money on a program that produces $100 of education or something like that to send more students to Simon Fraser. So the government can be doing use the money for whatever it is using the money for. It could do something. But that's not what we're talking about from the first step, which is taxing, right? If you take the tax money, the money is gone. It's just a transfer. How they use the money, if they use the money for education and produce $100 of benefits, that's great. If they use it to go shoot people in another country, the American method of spending money, then it's negative, right? Because you just kill a bunch of people. So the tax revenue is not in itself a good or a bad thing. What you do with it is a different story. We're going to ignore that for now. So we got this, we got this, and then, so in this process, we have hired some workers, we have moved some oil, we have increased revenue to oil, right? And all of those, and that's, but most of the stuff is cancellation. The taxes are canceled, the cost of the pipeline is canceled, or the workers are costs, and so on, right? If this company could find a way of, sorry, this company could find a way of building a pipeline for 40 instead of 50, would society be better off? Would the company be better off? Would society be better off? Because over there, the 50 would go to 40, right? Now there's this other thing called oil, which is what we're moving. We're not moving milk in the pipeline, right? We're moving oil. And if we're going to do a cost benefit, we have to think about the externality problem. One other thing. There's a whole bunch of bullshit analysis that goes on called, if the worker gets paid $50 and goes out and buys a sandwich, that's going to keep a sandwich maker employed, and the sandwich maker goes to the bar, buys a beer, and that keeps the bartender employed. The multiplier effects that are just basically bullshit, right? You can get, you can get an economist who will tell you any multiplier you want as long as you put enough money on the table, right? Cost benefit. You give me money, I'll tell you whatever you want multiplier, right? It's basically made up stuff. A lot of consultants do this for a living, so sorry for consultants who do this for a living. They make good money, but it's, from a social perspective, it's bullshit. Because when you add up all the multipliers, I hired a sandwich maker who hired a beer maker. If you add up all the multipliers, society is suddenly twice as big or three times as big. Because that sandwich maker also works for the guy who's a construction worker. The beer guy is serving the politician. There's too much double counting. It's double counting. It's like saying, it's like not canceling the $100, right? Don't get caught with double counting problems. Okay, so we bring up the externalities. There's two kinds of externalities as far as oil is concerned. The first one, the easy one, is oil spill. Oops, pollution, right? Local problem. The pipeline, this is an oil company. The pipeline company is more concerned about pollution from local pollution. And this is a benefit to them. And if there's a spill, is the spill a cost to who? Cities, local people, the environment, right? But it could be, so if there's a spill, from a social perspective, we know it's over here. If the company doesn't have to pay for the cost of the spill, because the government says, we'll take care of you, then the company has a very weak incentive to do what? Prevent spills, right? Oops, I spilled. Oh, I'm going to walk away. It's like people who litter. They just like leave their garbage on the ground and walk away. It's like, well, that's someone else's problem. Or even worse, I'm creating jobs. I'm a job creator. Right? Someone's got to pick that up. That's why I drink beer and I leave my cans on the road so the homeless people can have a job. Right? Thank God for homeless people, otherwise they couldn't litter. I've had this conversation with people. It's like, yeah, I'm helping people. Crazy. So the spill is a cost, we know, right? The company will take that cost into account if it has to pay for the spill, right? There's this discussion about the, is it Enbridge? That BC says, we demand a world-class spill response team or something like that. They just made up some huge Superman wording. Is Enbridge going to pay for that? They should, right? And what if the world-class team doesn't world-class respond, right? Because they're like, at Tim's, they're like, spill, right? Got to finish my coffee. So there's a big question about who's going to pay and if it's going to actually minimize the costs, right? When the British Petroleum spill, the Deepwater Horizon spill in the Gulf of Mexico brought on an enormous amount of spill cleanup types of people, right? And that was paid for by BP mostly. But the U.S. government had its own role of screwing that up. So if you put in the cost of a spill, if you internalize the externality and you say you guys are responsible for this, then there is no benefit to the spill, but the cost will be minimized. How do I say this? This is, in a sense, a cost that we have to count this cost. It's only a cost. Here's how we do it. The company is making 100 and they're spending 50, right? They have to worry. Now we're going to say you have to worry about the cost of a spill. The cost of the spill is unknown. How big is the spill? Where does it occur? How many lawyers are involved? If the cost of a spill is estimated at $60 because of a long calculation process, is this a good pipeline or a bad pipeline from that company's perspective? What? Right. Expected value, $60. 110 versus 100, don't do the pipeline. Too much cost, too much risk. There's different ways of getting away from that. One is the government guarantees your risk. Great. Incompetent government. The other one is you build or design a better pipeline that costs $80 and you reduce the spill losses to $10 estimated. Good pipeline or bad pipeline? Good pipeline now, right? And you spend the $80, that's cash money gone. And if there is no spill, you get to keep the $10. But there is a spill, theoretically you'll spend $10 cleaning it up. This is a really good way to do cost-benefit analysis. That's when you really need to have a good number on this. Because once the spill damage is calculated against the cost, you can make a good decision. Do I have a minute still? Okay, hold on. The last thing. So the spill cost, let's say the estimated spill cost is, let's go this to 80, and the estimated spill cost is 10, social 200 versus 90. Social is Canada. If we go and we burn all that oil, we don't. Canada doesn't burn it. It goes overseas and gets burned, and carbon dioxide goes in the atmosphere. Then there is a negative externality of, say, 150, right? Global warming, greenhouse gases. From a global perspective, is this a good idea or a bad idea? Bad idea, right? Costs are greater than benefits. But who bears the costs and who bears the benefits? Right? Sorry? You will not bear the costs. Or you will. We. All. We all will bear the costs. But as far as the oil industry in Canada is concerned, this is not relevant. It's true. Right? That's what Chris was talking about last week. And that's why cost benefit is significant. Like, who are you representing? Are you representing society, Canada, and so on? All right. Great.